Good afternoon. I'm Susan Saxon, along with Lisa Lane in the back with the camera up in front of her face. We are the co-founders and co-executive directors of Project Hope Foundation, a nonprofit organization that is based out of South Carolina, and our mission is to provide a lifespan of autism services across all ages, across the autism spectrum, and across all programs. When we started Project Hope Foundation 20 years ago, we did so as moms of young sons with autism. Back when we started Project Hope, the rate of autism was 1 in 2,500. And even at that point in time, the need for services was urgent. As you have heard today on several occasions, that rate has skyrocketed to 1 in 68, 1 in 42 boys, and services are still not widely available for children. As Dr. Skinner said this morning, and we have heard a couple of times, the average age for diagnosis of autism is 4 years. 4 years, which means that most kids don't even have access to services during that time when services can have the greatest impact. And diagnosis still continues to be one of diagnosis by symptoms, which is one of many reasons, but this is one that we're so excited to be part of the Helix and Hope collaboration with Greenwood Genetic Center, bringing together science that you heard all about this morning, and services, which you're going to hear about this afternoon. A partnership that will also hopefully bring about some exciting new diagnostic tools, tools that can honestly make such a difference in the lives of these children, their families, and in our community. There are some very scary statistics that go along with autism. You may be aware that 30% of the children diagnosed with autism never speak. They're nonverbal. They can't even express their most basic wants and needs. They can't say, I'm hungry, I hurt, I need a bathroom. As a mom, the saddest part for me is they can't say things like, I love you, mommy, or I love you, daddy, or even just mommy and daddy. Those precious words that we as parents need to hear. 50% of them wander off, and it's called elopement. They're not running away or intentionally going away. They just literally wander away, and they get lost, and then they have no idea how to get back. And they, if they're nonverbal, then can I tell you who they are or how they got there or where they need to be? If you listen to the news or you read the newspaper, then you know that situations like this often have very catastrophic results. 84% of them will always live at home with their parents, at least until their parents can no longer take care of them or are not there to take care of them. And that brings up a whole nother difficult situation because there is a dearth of housing, appropriate long-term housing for this population. 92%, which is essentially all of them, will be unemployed as adults. And the fact is that there is a tsunami of adults coming. Over the next decade, 500 youth will age into adulthood. And that's a scary reality for their families, and it should be a scary reality for our community because these individuals will likely outlive their parents. And that means if there's not appropriate housing, what's going to happen to them? If they don't have siblings or relatives who can take care of them, what's going to happen to them? Autism doesn't just affect the child and the family. Autism impacts the community. It impacts the community because it's going to fall upon us to take care of them. And the conservative estimate for the cost to do just that, to take care of them over their lifetime, is $2.4 million. If that's not a financial impact on the community, I'm not sure what is. So there are some hopeful statistics that also go along with autism. With Project Hope Foundation Services, we know that 96% of our clients will gain significant measurable skills. Critical skills like learning to communicate, life-changing skills. We also know that 48% of them will gain so many skills that they will be able to be successful members of a mainstream classroom. Even more exciting, we know that if we can get them into our services before age 3, that 48%, almost half, will jump into an astounding 86%, mainstreaming into regular classrooms, into regular life. We are very excited to have many innovative partners who are participating and supporting us, who are helping to open doors for our clients and helping us to be more successful with our mission. Project Hope Foundation has 9 core programs, but our largest program is our Hope Reach program, where we provide applied behavior analysis, ABA therapy, to over 200 children across the upstate and here in Greenwood. Each of these children are receiving approximately 25 to 40 hours per week of intensive one-on-one therapy. And ABA is nationally recognized as the best practices therapy for children with autism. There are literally hundreds of peer-reviewed studies supporting its efficacy. It is provided through a team-tiered structure. That structure is led by a board-certified behavior analyst, a BCBA, and who assesses the child and develops a treatment plan. That treatment plan is delivered by line therapists who in today's world are credentialed as registered behavioral technicians. They are the ones who are working with that child one-on-one for blocks of time, usually 2.5 to 3.5 hours at a time. And then there's a lead or senior therapist who is the one who is overseeing that plan on a day-to-day basis and troubleshooting. So a child's monthly schedule might look something like this. 5 days a week of therapy, 25 to 40 hours a week. On a day-to-day basis, they would be doing that therapy in blocks of time, working with a different registered behavior technician or RBT in each session. So there's a morning session, an early afternoon session, a late afternoon session. And then very critical to our program is we do a monthly team meeting. That's a very important part of what we do. In that team meeting, that BCBA, the senior therapist, the line therapist, and of course the parents and the child come together to review that program, to assess the goals and objectives and how well that child is doing. It's critical to be on the same page. It helps us to deliver better therapy. And it's so important to us to provide this that we are providing this team meeting often with no reimbursement. It's a 3 to 4 hour meeting every month, a meeting that we lose money on, but we gain so much more in the process. The child and the family gain so much more in the process. ABA therapy usually has 2 basic focuses. The first one is to build skills. Each session, that line therapist and everyone involved with that child is taking data using an iPad mini, and they're using a Catalyst software system where they're recording the performance of that child. So you can see on there, they're looking at programs that are literally designed to build that child's skills. And we continue to build on those skills and expand those skills, working constantly to increase the independence level for that child. In addition to working to build skills, we are working to replace those problem behaviors that interfere with that child's ability to function within his family and within the world around him, replacing those behaviors with something that is workable and more acceptable. So So again, we're taking data and we're graphing that data to see how do we tweak that program on a consistent basis to make it as effective as we possibly can. Project Hope Foundation is one of very few nonprofit providers of ABA therapy. And most programs are typically funded in several different ways. The first way is through BabyNet, but most kids don't have access to BabyNet because it only covers 0 to 3. And we just said that the average age of diagnosis is 4, so most of them will miss BabyNet entirely. It's also covered by the PDD waiver, which started, I believe, in 2007 as a funding source. It began as a lottery and quickly grew into a huge waiting list. This program serves children 3 to 10, and it will be phased out in December. The other main funding source is insurance. That came into being with Ryan's Law, an insurance mandate in South Carolina. It has been a tremendous asset to providers across the state. Lots of insurance companies are compared to what it used to be are covering it, but there are still some tremendous gaps in what's available through insurance. For example, if you are with a company that is self-insured or your company has less than 50 employees, then you're exempt. If your insurance company is out of state, then you probably do not have ABA therapy for your child. So it's still difficult in the state of South Carolina to fund an ABA therapy program. Which brings us to Medicaid. Most children with autism qualify for TEFRA medication. Most of you know what that is? Okay. TEFRA is strictly based on that child's disability. It has nothing to do with parental income. So most kids with autism will have access to Medicaid coverage. In 2014, the Centers for Medicaid and Medicare Services, CMS, mandated that all kids, all children and adults 0 to 21 should receive ABA coverage for ABA therapy through Medicaid. That was fabulous news, because that meant those kids who had been waiting and waiting and waiting, and those who were just getting diagnosed, would have access to ABA therapy thanks to Medicaid. And it literally leveled the playing field, because if you didn't have access to insurance, you now had access to ABA therapy. The problem is that South Carolina has one of the lowest reimbursement rates in the country, and most providers are unable to accept it. South Carolina Department of Health and Human Services is refusing to raise that rate to a sustainable level. Sadly, you can make more money working at Starbucks serving coffee than you can working as a registered behavioral technician for an ABA provider. The loaded reimbursement rate in South Carolina is $17.26 an hour. And with that rate, providers have to cover salary, benefits, hiring and training costs, mandated supervision costs, and any overhead that is associated with providing ABA therapy to children within their home or within their clinic, which we have a number of clinics. It honestly is just not doable for any of us. But the bottom line is, what is the impact on children? Some providers, as a result of this rate, and this is a rate increase that we have been waiting for 3 years, and what they came back with was $17.26, compared to $40 an hour in North Carolina. The impact is that many providers are literally closing their doors. And those kids who have been receiving services from those providers are now going to other providers, and what those families are hearing is, I'm sorry, we're not taking new Medicaid clients. So those kids who have been receiving services and have been making progress are now, if they can find a list to go on, are at the bottom of that list. The providers who, we cannot stay in business by taking Medicaid. It's just financially not possible. If you run the business plan, you're not going to be in business very long. Some estimate that there are now over 2,000 kids on the waiting list with autism to receive ABA therapy. And truly, that is heartbreaking. So let's move to something a little bit happier. Project Hope Foundation, in addition to providing ABA therapy, provides a variety of classroom models where we serve our clients who are on the spectrum. We have inclusion classrooms where we serve children with autism learning side by side with neurotypical learners. This is the first program that we started years ago, 20 years ago, and in this program we serve preschoolers through elementary age. We also have a Bridging the Gap program, which you will hear about in just a few moments from Andrea. And in that classroom, we're serving autism, only autism students, and it's very much modeled with an ABA model. We serve preschool up through high school with this model. And then for our more challenged students, we have a middle and high school program that we call Bridging our Hope Alive Junior. And in this one, we are working on communication skills and life skills and community skills, preparing them for the highest level of independence that is possible. Through our Hope Leaders program, we support team meetings and provide workshops for parents who don't have access to ABA therapy services or who are waiting for those services to begin. We deliver professional trainings to professionals who work with it, to educators, to physicians. Quite frankly, we will talk to anybody, anytime, anywhere, in hopes of helping to improve services for clients and for families and for the community. We truly believe that we are all part of the solution, and we want to help to be part of that solution. Additionally, we are, as part of our, in keeping with our mission to provide a lifespan of services, we are now also providing adult services where we're working on communication skills to enhance those. We're working on social skills, which is, we all know with our adults, that's still one of those challenges that they have, and we're working on employment skills. We have been collaborating with South Carolina Department of Vocational Rehabilitation and a company known as Big Brain Staffing to prepare our adult clients for the workforce. We are a nonprofit organization serving multiple locations and multiple programs throughout the state as one nonprofit organization. We began our life as a small preschool out of Advent United Methodist Church 20 years ago, serving 18 children with 6 teachers. And we are now in the... Is it not moving? I promise you I'm moving it. There we go. That's too much. 1 second. We are now in the process. We have purchased land in Malden, South Carolina on Butler Road, next to this amazing 7-acre park, and we are in the process of raising funds to build a new Hope Academy, a permanent home for our program, where we will have preschool through middle school and some therapy services located there as well. But in the meantime, we are operating out of the Temple of Israel, located near Haywood Road, near the Haywood Mall. So we are serving there all of our preschool and elementary inclusion and Bridging the Gap programs. We are also in the process, if any of you are from the Spartanburg area, renovating a building there in the downtown. It'll be our downtown Spartanburg campus where we will be providing ABA therapy and Bridging the Gap classrooms. And we have a clinic out of our Woodruff, South Carolina location where we are providing ABA therapy. We have our middle and high school Bridging the Gap programs located there, along with adult programs and our Hope Alive Junior classrooms. We have been very excited to have an iCard driving simulator at our Woodruff clinic. I don't know if any of you have ever seen one, but it's an amazing piece of equipment that allows us to work with some of our older clients on learning how to drive. But it also allows us to teach some of our younger clients how to be a better passenger. Many of our clients are pretty much homebound or distance-bound because they have children who do not like to ride in vehicles. And we're able to help them by making their children learn to be more comfortable. There's nothing worse than taking a ride with a screaming four-year-old who is throwing all of their clothing, their shoes included, out on the interstate as you're trying to go somewhere, and I know that one from personal experience. So in this, we also have on site at the Bluebirds location a life skills house. And it's a real house where we can work on real, real life skills. Our clients there are learning to cook using food that they are purchasing themselves from grocery lists that they have prepared to make food that they have done the menus for, so that they're learning to cook. That's a skill that you can then take home. For many of our families, just having their adult member be a more functional part of that family, that is such a gift. The first time my son came home and said, "Mom, can I fix tacos for dinner?" It was fabulous because I don't cook. So it was really exciting to have a home-cooked meal. It was great. Here they're learning to do their own laundry, to fold their clothes, and to hang their clothes. Hygiene and toileting skills, even though these are adults, may still be difficult things for them. And that's the hard, frustrating thing for parents to work on. So that's something that we can target there. We have a home bathroom where they can learn those skills of shutting the door and using a bar of soap and drying their hands on a towel. But to help them to be more comfortable in commercial bathrooms, we have one of those too. So they can go into that bathroom and learn to use a stall and become accustomed to those noisy hand dryers so that when they do go to Walmart with their family, going to the bathroom is not such a challenge. On our Woodruff campus, we also have 13 acres for expansion. And part of what we hope to do is to focus on those adult services there. Long-term housing, when we can figure out what that needs to look like for our population is on our agenda of what we want to do. So it's not moving. And we opened in September a clinical space here in Greenwood. A 58,000 square foot space that was donated to us. And in this space, we are expanding our ABA service component. And we are invite anybody from the Greenwood area to come and visit. We are quite excited about that growth. So we are a nonprofit organization serving across the state. We are serving across the ages, across the autism spectrum, and across all programs, providing a lifespan of autism services. I appreciate it very much.